Now, these photos only came to light after the photographer who had taken the photo had died, a policeman who was at the deportation scene and must have held the camera under his coat hidden because it was prohibited to pay any attention of any sort whatsoever, let alone take photographs, let alone talk about it, about the deportation of the Jews.
When Dreyfus came across these images by accident, he was shocked to see that one of the pictures contained his grandfather. Both his maternal grandparents died in concentration camps. His paternal grandmother took poison on the day of her deportation.
She took a poison that was given to her by her brother-in-law, a doctor, and she died rather gruesomely. If you read the Gestapo report, which you can read in Düsseldorf in the archives, that she didn't die straight away when the neighbours called the police, and she was still, sort of rattling. It must have been quite a gruesome death, I would imagine.
Just 3 months before the declaration of war, George, his brother, and 15 other Jewish children were placed on a ship that brought them safely to Australia. They were taken to a children's home in Melbourne called Larino, not knowing if they would ever see their parents again. As it turned out, the Dreyfus boys were the only children from Larino whose parents came to get them. Dreyfus attended the elite Melbourne High School, but claims he was not much of a student. In 1946, during his matriculation year, he was also doing the first year of a Bachelor of Music at the Melbourne Conservatorium. He failed both.
Well, I left home when I was about 16 and went to Melbourne, and George, I don't know what brought us together, but he became one of my first friends at the conservatorium. I remember going to his house often, and I was just a naive 16-year-old Tasmanian. It was my first encounter with Jewish household, and I was really excited by it. Just when I'd walk in the door, the smells of cooking, and his mother was a great beauty, and I just thought she was marvellous.
She was, to her dying day, a music lover, but could not play a musical instrument. But she was a music lover, and certainly encouraged me in my career as a young musician when my father really wanted to have me continue his carpet cleaning business, which I don't wish on anybody. And she encouraged me.
The first big break for Dreyfus came in 1948 when he was offered a job with J.C. Williamson's Italian Opera Company. Within a few years, he joined the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra as second bassoonist.
Nobody else turned up. The bassoon player died, Fred Morgan died, and there were no other applicants.
In 1955, Dreyfus received a scholarship from the German government to study at the Vienna Academy of Music. 3 years later, he returned to the MSO.
There was no doubt when I came back the second time to the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra, there was a certain inner restlessness in me because of the terrific tuition that I had received in Vienna, which made my orchestral life very easy. And perhaps when it's too easy, you get bored.
Dreyfus struggled on as a reluctant member of the orchestra for a number of years, until finally, he became the first member of the MSO ever to have been sacked.
He'll tell you probably the reason he was thrown out of the orchestra was, according to one of the authorities, for, lovely phrase, what was it, dumb insolence, I think it was. And he will tell you that at the time he didn't care. He'd go into rehearsals with his leather jacket on, his long hair, and he was determined to be a rebel. And in other words, he was sort of saying, you know, come on, give it to me kind of thing, you know, knock me out. And they did.
It was all wrong, and it was just as well that the management had the courage to say goodbye to me, because I would have never really had the courage to do it on my own.